ただいまより
We will now start the Innovative City Forum. This is an international conference to debate the future design of cities and lifestyles. Experts at the forefront of leading-edge technologies, urban development, arts and creativity from Japan and abroad are gathered to engage in interdisciplinary discussion, information sharing and exchange. First, on behalf of the organizer, Professor of Keio University, Chairman of Institute for Urban Strategies, Mori Memorial Foundation, and Director of Academy Hills, Heizo Takenaka will deliver the welcome remark. Dr. Takenaka, please. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the introduction. I am the Chairman of the Institute for Urban Strategies, Mori Memorial Foundation, and Director of Academy Hills. My name is Heizo Takenaka. Welcome to the second Innovative City Forum. We have a wonderful lineup of speakers from Japan and all around the world. I'm very pleased as a member of the organizer, and I thank deeply to all those who have assisted to make this possible. Actually, last year we had the first Innovative City Forum, and we received many words of encouragement. And that led to our being able to host this second forum. As the moderator mentioned, the future of cities and future of our lifestyles, what's going to happen? How can we make it better in 10 or 20 years? We would like to deepen that discussion. We like to introduce technology, art, and science, various new elements. We want to look at that in a comprehensive manner and have a creative discussion. So this is a forum that we want to establish as a permanent institution. Well, last year, the first session was held on the 16th of October, and on that day, we were hit by a typhoon. Well, last weekend, there was a typhoon, another one coming next weekend. And the Nobel Prize winners are being announced now. So when you think about typhoon season and the Nobel Prize season, please remember Innovative City Forum. So we have Mr. Shimomura, Minister in charge of the Olympics and the Paralympics. And also we have wonderful speakers, people at the forefront of various fields to address you. So I encourage you to actively participate in the discussions, and there are various side events already being held or being held. Yesterday, there was a special session co-organized with the Japan Foundation. So it was a session about Asian art, and there are various events taking place concurrently. And the new landmark of Tokyo, attracting a lot of attention, is Tonamon Hills, and I'm very pleased that we're able to hold this second forum here at this new Tokyo landmark. So let's spend two creative days starting from today. That's what I would like to ask of you. And once again, I would like to thank Mori Building and all the other people who have made this forum possible. So this Innovative City Forum, the second forum, is now going to begin. Thank you very much.
Takenaka-sensei, arigatou.
Thank you very much, Professor Takenaka. Now, today, we have many special guests being invited. And on behalf of the guests, I would like to ask the Minister for Education, Culture, Sports, and Science Technology to give a message, please. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As has been kindly introduced, my name is Shimomura. I'm the Minister of Education, Culture, Sports, and Science and Technology, and also Minister responsible for the Olympic and Paralympic Games in 2020. I am indeed very happy to be invited to the Innovative City Forum 2014. We see the aging as well as a declining birth rate in Japan, and also constraints of resources and energy. We also have natural disasters and many environmental the problems faced by Japan. And these are challenges on global scale. But amidst such circumstances, the day before yesterday, we had the three doctors, Dr. Isamu Akasaki, Dr. Hiroshi Amano, and Dr. Shuji Nakamura, who have received the Nobel Prize for Physics. This was indeed very encouraging and very happy news for all of us in Japan. The high quality of research, as well as the talents for the research in Japan, would be the best resource that we can boast to the whole world for this country. As one Japanese, I am really proud of this achievement. This Nobel Prize awarding being a trigger, I hope that we will be able to further strengthen the system for human resources development, to try to also develop more attractive research on the climate, so that Japan will be the best country, the most appropriate country for innovation in the world. Now, education, culture, and sports, as well as science and technology innovations, are all under my responsibilities, but Olympic Games and Paralympic Games in 6 years from now, 2020, is a target year in many ways to create an attractive nation. And I believe we are able to aim for such a goal. Olympic and Paralympic Games are the largest festival of humankind in the world. Back in 1964, we had the first Olympic and Paralympic Games in Tokyo. We celebrate the 50th anniversary. And these games are not just for sports, but on a comprehensive basis, culture, science, and technology, as well as the education. 2020 would be the target year to create a Japan newly as a revived at the country. Just the other day in Tianjin, I had the opportunity to participate in the Samanamos the conference, and in 2016, I have been told that in the autumn, after the Olympic and Paralympic Games that has been completed, 2,000 strong, the Davos conference for culture and sports to be held in Japan, and Japan, the Japanese government would like to support wholeheartedly such a program, so that together with all of you participating in the Innovative City Forum, so in the autumn of 2016, we will have a top-notch culture and sports experts from all over the world gathering, and young leaders of the World Economic Forum will also gather to Japan, so that we will be able to hold a good conference. And as we go towards the year 2020, we will be able to send a good message to the whole world from Japan. And the government of Japan would like to support such a feat wholeheartedly. Tokyo in the world, I must say, is the most creative city. That seems to be the assessment these days. And from Tokyo and from Japan, we hope to send a good message to give birth to many good ideas. And although as a politician, I am faced with many challenges, including the declining birth rate and aging, but with the power of people, with power of science and technology and talents, I hope that we will be able to be at the starting point. And for this purpose, Innovative City Forum 2014 discussion and debate should be something fruitful to come up with good proposals and good ideas to revitalize the Japanese economy and society. And as we go step by step towards the 2020, the whole of Japan as a nation and society, including the local economies, to be further revitalized, we will be able to see a better future for all of us. Thank you very much. Congratulations once again.
Shimamura Daiji.
Thank you very much, Minister Shimamura, for that. We'd like to have Professor Takenawa once again stand at the podium and talk about city brainstorming. Over to you, Professor Takenaka. Thank you very much. Minister Shimomura gave us very gracious words. I'd like to thank him for that. So we'd like to start the program at this point. Last year, we had a diverse series of sessions. And before that, we felt that we needed to create a platform, a common platform which runs through the program. And so we organized this city planning session. Do you have switches? Do you have your remote control for the questionnaire? You have. We'd like to take a survey as to what kind of awareness you have. This is to confirm that. This is a mini questionnaire survey, and we want to start our discussions with a common awareness. Last year, this was received very well, so we'd like to do this again. And if this is favorable, receives a favorable acceptance this time, this event will become a permanent one. Otherwise, this questionnaire survey will see an end this time if it's not received well. So I'd like to test, conduct a test. You have your remote control. I don't have one. Do you? There should be a number from one to something. There are numbers on your gadgets. Then we'll do a test. This is the question. Among those who are, here today, who's over, who's 50 years or above, press 1. Those under 49 or under should press 2. Those 50 or above should press 1. And those 59 and under should press 2. So please. Go. Those 50 or above should press 1. 2 is 49 or under. Oh, we've got the data already. 64%, two-thirds are relatively young. I don't believe anyone's lying from what I see. So we've conducted the test. I'd like to move to the first question. I forgot to mention earlier on, during this period of this event, Mori Foundation's Institute for Urban Strategies has been doing a ranking of the world cities, and we will be announcing the results of that this afternoon. The first question is this. Aren't we getting the results yet? In 2020, when the Olympic Paralympic Games will be held, what will the city ranking of Tokyo be? Will it be above the present ranking, or will it see a decline in ranking? Presently, Tokyo is ranked fourth, by the way. One is will be higher, two is will be lower, and three will stay the same. So please press either 1, 2, or 3. We've got the numbers on the bottom right, and these are the results. Those who think Tokyo's ranking will be higher would be, what percentage would that be? 59%. And those who think we'll see a lower ranking is 12%. So that's how people feel. Actually, will be higher is 59%. I'll do something a bit mean. This is the same question that we asked last year. Last year, for the same will be higher category, it was 73%. So people have turned pessimistic. Do we look at it that way? There are two hypotheses. You can say that people have become more pessimistic. They're more concerned about Tokyo's ranking. And the second possibility is that the people who answer are answering at random. They don't really care about being accurate. The second question. What is more important for future cities? Total planning based on leadership? That would be one. And free activities, leaving things up to the private sector and creating an order from that freedom. Those who feel that total planning based on leadership is important, press one, and press two for free activities. Thank you very much. Those who felt that leadership was important was 56%. 56.3%. That's 147 at 56.3%. Free activities, 43.7%. This is correct, isn't it? Is this correct? Let's show what we had last year. This is proof of the fact that everybody is not doing this at random, just doing what they feel like doing. It's very accurate and it's amazing. So both are important, but more people tend to feel that leadership is important. The questions after this one will be new questions, so please don't be concerned about what you answered last year. 2025 in Tokyo, what characteristics would you like to see more of in Tokyo? What will you be asking of Tokyo? We said that 2025, that would be after 2020, the Olympic Games. 2025, by the way, is when the baby boomers would fit in the senior citizens category. And so that would be the peak of the aging of the society, and the economic society will probably see a major change. Number one is growth. Number two is comfort. Number three is sustainability. Number four is diversity. Whether it's growth or comfort or sustainability or diversity. That's one, two, three, and four. So please go ahead and answer. The overall aggregate number seems to have increased. Growth is 23. Second, comfort is 83. Sustainability, environmental friendliness is 57. And amazingly, diversity is 104. That's really surprising, 39%. So, of course, since this is a city, growth and comfort is important. But at this point in time, more people are looking for diversity in Tokyo. By far, that has the highest number, and then followed by comfort. At the present point in time, the lowest is growth. So while we're seeing maturity, women and participation from overseas, these are what people are looking for in Tokyo. It's really quite understandable. Diversity is 39%. That's 40%. That's quite impressive. We had some applause there. Thank you very much. And in the after sessions, in the sessions to follow, please discuss this issue. Same year, 2025, which of the following cities do you think will be most prosperous? London, New York, Paris, Tokyo. We won't be able to announce the results of this year's ranking until this afternoon, but from 1 through 4, London, New York, Paris, Tokyo, which of these cities will be prospering most in 2025? Now, how do you measure prosperity? What do you perceive of as a prosperity? We leave that up to you to decide. So from London to Tokyo, please press the appropriate button. Thank you very much. London, surprisingly, has a low number. London is first. 2 years ago, London surpassed New York to become number one. Again, New York is expected to surpass London. That is what a lot of people think. And expectations for Tokyo is extremely high. Because we're doing the survey in Tokyo, if we should discount that. But despite this fact, people do have high expectations of Tokyo. So the sessions after this, Mr. Ichikawa will be moderating one of the sessions. So What is your impression, Professor Ichikawa? We'd like to ask Mr. Ichikawa. Starting 16 hours, Tokyo, New York, London, Paris. There'll be an announcement about what these cities will be like 10 years from now. The element of surprise is that it was our impression that London is really growing recently, but people do really believe in Tokyo, and Tokyo rising, I think this is a very large, high number. There are hopes and wishes included in this result. But please stay tuned for results this afternoon to see if how this matches with the numbers that we arrived at today. In the afternoon, we'll be doing a press conference and we'll be announcing the city rankings. So please look out for this. Next question. In 2025, will cities... lifestyle be improved by science and technology? What will cities be like? What will be our lifestyles be like in 2025? That's the objective of this exercise, of this forum. What would will be the role of science and technology? Will it be better? Will it be worse? Or will nothing be changed? These concern your expectations of science and technology. So please choose from among 1 through 3. So let's see what the results look like. By far, we have the will be better numbers. And then there are those who feel that it will be worse. And then there are things, people who think will not be changed. If you don't mind, who answered will be worse? Among the 10, anyone care to elaborate on your opinion among those who felt that will be worse, who, the science of technology will make things worse? Nobody's willing to elaborate? Maybe you're shy. As to actually what will happen, I asked the science of technology this time. But I myself do not know how to distinguish between science and technology. The demarcation is very difficult. In the relevant session, the moderator, MIT Media Labs, Mr. Ito's here. Could you give us some leads as to how we should think about the demarcation between science and technology? Yes, thank you very much. I'll be referring to that later on in my talk, so I don't want to go into depth on this. But everyone has high expectations, and that's a large part of this. If it were me, I would be looking more at the will be worse potential. Whether it be better or will it be worse, it will depend on how what decisions we make and how we design the cities. So business as usual, making things better, is a bit optimistic, I think. That's a wonderful preview. And so we look forward to the keynote speech. Science and technology will make things better, but it would be through the efforts that we make. It'll not be based on what God provides us with. We'll have to make the effort. So let's look forward to what he has to say later on. The last question, will cities and lifestyle be improved by art and design in 20 years? This time we're talking about art and design. Will it be better? Will it be worse? Or will things not be changed? So please choose between numbers 1 through 3. So here again, we have the highest number of people saying will be better, and then those who answered will be worse. And then among those of you who answered will be worse, who's courageous enough to elaborate, expand on your views? No one? So we know that not everyone thinks art and design will make things better. Mori Art Museum's director, Mr. Nanjo, do you have anything to say on this result? Also, in terms of the relationship between art and design. Yes. art is such that it's the way you look at the world, your worldview, and it's a concept. Design is about the practical aspect, making things commercial, and it's about technology. So art demonstrates how you view things, and those who answered will be improved. Art proposes the standards for deciding whether it's will be improved. So whether things have improved or not depends on how you look at things. So it's not easily decided. If you think things are better, it'll become better. If you think things are bad, it's bad. So it depends on your standard, and that's art. It is what art is about. But we'll leave the rest up to the discussions. We want to do a questionnaire as to whether people understood his answer or not. I'd definitely like to do a survey on this, but we hope that this will be discussed in the following sessions. And so in this way, as a platform, we now understand the audience's thinking and what to focus on in participating in the discussions and in listening to the discussions. We hope you'll think about this based on these results. Now we'd like to move into the substance of the Innovative City Forum from now on. So please look forward to this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Takenaka. Now, may I invite Mr. Joichi Ito, Director of MIT Media Lab, to give us the keynote address, Embracing Complexity Through a New Science of Design. So, Dr. Ito, please. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It was indeed very timely that just yesterday there was an announcement of the collaboration between Mori at the building and at the Media Lab. So inclusive of what I will be discussing today, I would like to think through on what would be the future of the cities going forward. As is related to questions asked in the questionnaire survey earlier, the society is becoming increasingly complex, and the impact of science and technology is increasingly relevant. And how to think about the design of the city, inclusive of those aspects, is something I would like to talk about. Now, do I have the slides? Can I have the slides? I am an internet person. I have been immersed in internet, so I am rather biased. Looking at the world, including my own life, I believe I can divide our times before internet, BI, and after internet. The existence of internet divides our age. So including the economy and so forth, everything was slow before internet. And economists, their forecasts and prediction have often proved right. But as the internet have come into being, everything became complex, and the rules that were easy for us to understand have become even difficult and complicated. I'm not trying to be mean to Professor Takenaka, but things are indeed very difficult. The life is even more difficult for economists like Professor Takenaka. And in the world of the chaos, the chaotic, the presence, how can we survive, including the businesses? This is the image I would like to have in mind. The science and technology so far has been where the engineers and researchers will develop or invent something, and then it will be robots or spacesuit, the human being, that would perhaps in the future be able to project ourselves into the space. But rather, this may be the image we are holding for us right now. We have in the past, through science and technology, tried to control nature. And we will benefit from science and technology, and we will acquire the energy and resource from the system. So try to bring in more efficiency into the society and economy. But then what we thought was quite unlimited was quite limited and scarce. And all the systems are indeed connected. Everything is so complex. It is not that we will benefit. We may also lose in a certain way. And when we do something, as a consequence, the environment may be impacted, just as in the case of BI and AI. We do not know what will happen. So the people thinking about science and technology in that other background should think in terms of nature or ecology. And looking at the life itself, the genes, we are increasingly understanding more about our DNA, the genes. So there is a genetic design, and with a very fast speed, this is being realized. So life, nature, and city. We need to think in all the different scales and levels, and they are all connected. And from the gene to the society, and you have human beings in between, and everything is connected as a whole. And cities, everything was visible, but we need to think about invisibles, such as social media and the invisible biology, everything. And you need for us to design and plan for the city, we need to think about the complexity and why everything has become more complex and why is it impacting all of us. Let me give you an analogy, an example. Back in 1993, my bathroom was like this. There were junks filling my bathroom, computer parts and components at about 100,000 yen or so. And this was the very first commercial-based internet provider. The telephone carriers that were trying to come up with the good service with the physical buildings and hundreds of millions of yen had been invested. But people like us, just the students, poor students, through telecommunications, we will be able to launch a venture business. And that was the crux of the internet. That was the secret of the internet. You can see that everyone can compete and everyone can participate. So the cost will become very cheap. And another thing is, it is permissionless innovation, is what I call. Internet is not just technology, but it is philosophy as well. Philosophy meaning that everyone can participate. Even we, the poor students, could participate. And through internet, the cost will be cheaper, and a distribution cost, collaboration cost, and communication cost, everything will become cheaper. And what will happen with Wikipedia and Linux, open source, the free software, will expand and multiply. And Moore's law means that the computer will be a very fast speed. Every 18 months, it will become double the speed, and cost will be halved. And as the cost decreases and the network cost decreases, what I call innovation cost, to try to do something, the cost will be much cheaper. Let me give you an example. Do you remember Captain? Those of you in the 50 or over category would remember when NTT, anticipating the multimedia age, back in the 1980s, they made a public announcement, and they would have kiosks in different locations, and the contents would be shared by everybody. And they needed huge investments, and from network, computer, database, and contents, they had to develop everything, which means that they had to come up with a gigantic, enormous plan. And they spent a lot of money, and engineers were engaged, but they end in failure. Something like that, a similar system. In the after internet, in the age of AI, for instance, Google, Facebook, Yahoo, which are some of the daily services that we utilize every day. But then students will come up with their own ideas and develop their own systems on Google, on the PC. They'll open software, and then they would tweak that, and they would just connect to the university network. And the cost was zero. There was zero money involved in launching the service, the Google. They didn't have any business model, but instantly $5 billion will come their way. And the MBA, the banks and engineers, this is engineer, bank, and then pre-listing the engineer. So MBA, the plan-driven, but this is a design and engineer-driven world. This is a new world. The Boston is where I work. There are many big companies, big businesses. But the energy is flowing into the venture businesses in Silicon Valley. You don't need power or money. The money do not come to the power. But the money will flood into innovations. So through internet, innovation cost will be cheaper. and for money and power. Actually, the engineers, it will be innovation who has the most power. And that is a structure and system we see everywhere. This is the 3D printing. This is the printer made by my graduate student. And it is very easy to come up with a prototype, a hardware. And the printing device itself was developed by students. And these hardwares are now invented by these students. And she is a mole in the media lab. And the gadget, what she calls a gadget, the most favorable gadget, this is Samson's pick-and-place machine. 23,000 components per hour. The wheel will be placed on the electric circuit. This is very fast speed machine. One whole factory is now placed into this laboratory. 1,500 different kinds of products are being designed by her and being produced by her and be distributed by her. And the company is growing by 30% every year. So she has the whole factory by this machine. The design and manufacturing, everything is done by this one little machine. And in Shenzhen, I visited very recently, and Bunny over there, she was a guide, and I recently visited Shenzhen, where there are many factories and hub for manufacturing. And what the students have created as ideas could be instantly be brought to mass production. The cost is very cheap and skills are very high. I have mentioned Shenzhen. On the right-hand side is the electric circuit the factory. He is the boss of the factory and money. And him, I have negotiated with them. And what the Bunny told me is that the factory, the manager is always at the factory, and the manager and engineer and designer and the worker on the workshop are living together and having meals together. And they are immersed in work, and they are working very hard, very diligently. And the engineer, one of the engineers who were with us, up until 8 months ago, he was in fabrics, but now he is in semiconductor. And you have excellent and the highly capable people, so many people gathered. And I have been remembering the young entrepreneurs just after the Second World War in Japan. They must have been this energetic and this hopeful and this enthusiastic. But the Shenzhen, and as I compared to Japan, right after the Second World War. In Shenzhen, you have so many factories right now. And looking at their network, if he can do it, he can ask his aunt to do it. And in her factory, there is an iPhone components being manufactured and the human networking. The networking of factories is so superb. And the immersive of the mold, well, we wanted to create that. And if Professor Ito, if you want that many quantity, the mold itself, with the steel injection mold is very difficult. Maybe we are the only ones having technology, so we will produce for you. But it would be cheaper if you would produce back in the United States. So I will introduce to you. It used to be that it will be very expensive in the United States, but it will be cheaper in China, but no design in China. But right now, you have a design being done in China, but manufacturing to be done in the United States. It is totally reversed. So it is not that Shenzhen is cheaper and inexpensive, that you have the expertise and know-how there, and not just university professors, but the workers in the workshops. When I ask a question, they would always come up with an answer. So the strength and power and the capability. And when I try to link this to the city, we often call of the eco-city, how to create Silicon Valley in Singapore, and how can the ecosystem be recreated for art and for other purposes. The ecosystem in Shenzhen cannot be emulated. It's because these are human beings, this enthusiastic, so many people, and the technical prowess I don't think can happen anywhere. And when you go to the markets in the Shenzhen, you have so many mobile phones being sold. In Silicon Valley, in Tokyo, the apps are being designed and created by us. But in Shenzhen, the ordinary citizen will create their own mobile phone. Of course, the IPR is a totally separate question. But what is interesting is that in factories, they learn how to produce mobile phones. So they have come up with their own innovative ideas. And I will be discussing this during the panel discussion later. And the selling price is not just 900 yen, 5 mega, the OLED screen, and lithium battery, and GCM, and Bluetooth. Everything is included. So what the point I'm trying to make here is that for manufacturing system, a person who knows about the manufacturing processes, those are the only ones can design this. These are sold in Africa or Brazil. There are no screws involved. So the high-end designer, you don't think that this is beautiful or nice, but this cheap and this many functions are being incorporated. Only Shenzhen worker can come up with this. So what I'm trying to say is that you have designer and you have factory workers and you have the sketch and the PowerPoint and you're trying to negotiate with the manufacturing worker. But in Shenzhen, in the factory, the workers are designers already. And what Bunny tells me always is that designer should have the lubricant oil in your the hands, in your nails. And it used to be that in Japan as well, decades ago, the managers, the CEOs were always in the factory tweeting and tweaking and getting dirty and using your own hands. And it is just like that in Shenzhen today. So the message I would like to put to you is innovation cost in hardware is getting cheaper and cheaper. Everyone can produce hardware. So big businesses trying to develop hardwares, but it is now more of small businesses coming up with hardwares. And what the big businesses are doing, they are project managers, but it will be the software being the project management, and that would be the structure of venture businesses flourishing from now onwards. Now I would like to talk about biology. I'm sure you know about the company DuPont, and there is polyester sorona is one material that they have come up with, and the sugar content is included in a microorganism, and they create polyester from these microorganisms. And usually polyester is produced from petroleum. But using this microorganism, it is eco-friendly and 30% cheaper. So oil and petroleum-based polyesters are disappearing. In order to develop this biological organism, it took 7 years and $40 billion. So it is very hard for a small venture business to do. But with the Moore's Law, the cost is becoming cheaper and cheaper. And in just one chip, the NASA's whole computer is now being put on board. With a computer, design is made and fabrication is made, and everything is made by computer. And that is the process. The same thing is happening in biology. We talk about synthetic biology. Genetics and computer science have been melded together. So just like computer, the gene is now being analyzed as a language. So if you combine the two, they will be programming. And the programming could be incorporated into the bacteria. And if you reboot, then it will become a fuel, or it become a factory. It could become a sensor. So this is synthetic biology today. And this is the analytical part. So it's been only about 10 years or so. The human genome, it took $300 billion the first time. This is on a desktop gene sequencer. It is only about $100,000 or so. Then in 2 years' time, it will be just $100. And in 2020, it will be zero. The five or six times faster as compared to the Moore's Law. This is in our own laboratory.
You take the genes and you combine them. It's a machine that does this. If you want to create a certain gene, you send it to a Chinese factory, that you send the design, and they do this manually. 100 base pairs. To create that, it involves a lot of cost. But the error is about 1 in 10,000 with this machine. And all kinds of gene combination capacity, within a year or so, it's doable. And so the analytical technology and the combining structuring technology is such that the cost is coming down at a vast rate. This is just an analogy. This is very technical. Please bear with me. our student, Charles Fracchier, created this. It's an organism created by him. And the point here is a promoter. And what this is that measures whether in the peripheral areas there's sugar or not. When it finds sugar, it triggers, and the genes start to function. It's like a program. And what this part does is within the body, within the cell, it ejects the potassium. And what happens when potassium is ejected? Voltage goes up. And the voltage which has risen is measured by the sensor. It's hard to see this blue line. You inject sugar in here, a voltage goes up. And you can see that. And this is the device. There's a tiny electronic device here. And there's a microorganism here. And in his case, he wanted to create this all using electronics. He could have done that. But bio and electronics, the merger of this is what this project is about. And what's interesting is that if you want to make it look for other compounds, for example, toxic compounds or mines, landmines and so forth, if you change this part, the sensor changes. And if you do this using electronics, you have to remake everything. With the bio, it's very simply changed. And the bio is such that energy efficiency is very high. You don't need much energy. And statistically, sensing is very appropriate for this. And if he goes to an ordinary university, the bio people will say, get out, you're in electronics. And if he goes into the electronics department, he will be chased out because they think he belongs to the bio department. And the same with companies. There's rarely a merger between the two. In our entity, we have people like this who are coming in. Bio and electronics, these are separate fields, but they would be merged, and which to use will be decided on a case-by-case basis. This is in my kitchen, and we did an experiment here. I'll go into details later on. But this in Amazon, there's a substance called bioacin for cancer and for treatment of cancer and for parasites. It's used for treatment. It is 35 million, cost is 35 million, and it's very costly. How to create the microorganisms? And a professor did the analytical work, and the genes have been produced. There's a kit, and it was sent to us. And each one of these containers has a lot of genes, different genes. And personal computers are used to combine the genes. And bioacin, they create a creature that's able to create bioacin. They use interesting technology. And in the kitchen, they combine different genes. And the combined genes are taken to the heat shop. When heat is applied, the bacteria which is brought in has this gene injected, and the bacteria makes this function as a program, and it creates a bioacin. People like us, hundreds of people like this, share information to conduct experiments. As a result of these experiments, the most efficient process and the most efficient design is searched. And they try to find the most efficient way of creating bioacin, which would be helpful for the world. In the past, large pharmaceutical companies would do this in a laboratory, and several scientists would try different approaches, expending a lot of money. But we do this in the kitchen, and for future cancer treatment, we can participate in future cancer treatment. And this process, 10 years ago, would be worthy of two Nobel Prizes. There's a lot of technology involved in here, but we can do this in our kitchen, and it's becoming very simple. And street biology is what we call this. In the past, this would be done in a huge laboratory, such experiments of genes. But now a hackerspace or incubator or venture launching a space exists, and there's a bio sector. And this shining plant is created by a certain venture. And the development was done by young students on the street. And they did the work not in a big laboratory, but in their own space. And this is a spin-out from MIT. Every year, iGEM, a large This is a large genetic event. Mr. Kitano's here. Kitano-san has an event where they work with robots, and there's an event for robots. This is an event for genes. 2,000 high school students and university students use bacteria and more sophisticated things. There are some dangers involved here. They may create something which could cause illnesses and diseases. So the FDI is participating since the very initial stage, and they said something very interesting. During the internet age, young people cannot be controlled. So we threw the hackers into jail and we made them enemies. But we won't do this time. The young genetic hackers, we want them to be our friends and colleagues. And if there are problems, we want to solve this together. And as I recall, when the internet was born, the United States government since then has become much more open. And we play together. And we also think about safety in development, and we work together with the government. And the children, high school students create genes, and whether it's personal computers or mobile phones, in this room, who remembers when internet did not exist? I think many of you remember, but the young people don't know an age where there was no internet, and their brains are completely different because of this. Different research attests to this. In different ways, the brain is different, so these children are completely different creatures. And for the different creatures, we are thinking about cities and education for these creatures. We have these rigid, inflexible brains, and we're thinking for the benefit of these children. And this photograph is it last year or 20 years, 120 years ago? Education has not evolved during this time. I didn't like school much, so I'm biased, but encyclopedias, reading this from end to end was required before you were allowed to go out in the world. You had to work, study first, and then work later. Today, things have changed. This is a lie detector. And human beings' skin is such that when the brain starts to function, you can measure things on your skin. On a small glove, we attached a sensor. And MIT students, for 1 week, we measured the brain waves of, and it's very interesting. When they're studying, you see a very rigorous movement. When they're sleeping, when they're dreaming, there's some response here. During class, look at this. This is during class at university. And what's interesting is when they're relaxing, there's more movement than when they're in class. Maybe this was true even before the internet age, and we didn't know about it. When people are listening to lectures and learning, it's not really effective. The brain is not functioning, and so there can be no learning process. If you look at different sciences, when there is absolutely no context, even if you try to learn mathematics, you don't understand. The tests show that. If you're doing something and there's a context, it leads to a learning process. So creative learning, this is what we call it in our media lab. We talk about the four Ps: projects, peers, passions, passion, and play. And what this is about is the following. What we do first is to create something together. There's mathematics involved, physics and design involved. It's very practical, and it's easy to learn and remember, and people want to remember peers. Peers are working together with peers. When you take tests at school, you do that alone. And schools are such that people are divided by age category, so they don't learn from older peers. When you work with peers, you learn from people other than teachers, and that's very important. And next is passion. At schools, there should be passion. It's very necessary. But in Japan, the good students have no passion. They're like robots doing what they're told to do properly. And these students are evaluated highly as good students. And those who are very excited are thought of as being strange. But for learning, passion is very important. And play. And at schools or in companies, you're not supposed to play too much, especially according to Japanese virtues. The virtue in Japan is suffering. When you look at the recent trend, work that doesn't involve creativity, assembling things, or a very simple type of work is such that if you pressurize or if you give incentives, monetary incentives, people work hard. But when it comes to things requiring creativity, where you need to think about something, where you need to be autistic, if you apply pressure or if you give money, it has the opposite effect. It takes longer. There has to be an element of play. Otherwise, there's no creativity. In Japanese schools, you pick up a pencil and you take the test by yourself and you don't communicate with your peers and you don't play much. And you don't get involved in anything, and you want to be a good student. And that was what education was about up until now. But as seen through our eyes, creative learning is going in a different direction. So we're a little bit concerned about this. And anti-disciplinary is a word that I learned at Media Lab. When we choose professors, we use the word anti-disciplinary. Discipline is about different fields of study or fields of expertise. We collect people that are not bound by these disciplines. If a certain person wants to do something at a laboratory, then they should go there. And those who do not fit into any of these disciplines should come here. That is what we talk about. Science and chemistry and mathematics is such that the way people evaluate is in the following way. People, a Nobel Prize is the same way. People that are recognized by peers in the same field or the same sector is the criteria for evaluation. And so people go into depth into these certain field. But the expertise is that you have on a white piece of paper different dots and they're not connected. And we're trying to fill the white parts where there are no dots. And that's important, we think. This is a drawing made by a person called Ritschko, and he talks about himself. He's an artist, and at the same time, he's a scientist and designer and engineer. This is what he talked about. I was talking to Mr. Nanjo the other day, and we discussed the boundaries of art, and he said, everything is art. But he said, there's one condition. It can't be useful. It should not be useful. And that is the definition of art, I understood. So a difference between designer and artist is there. Designers are such that they need to create something useful in the end. Artists should not think about making something very useful. Scientists and engineers are very alike. We shouldn't ask the scientist as to the purpose of these studies. He wants to know more about nature. Engineers are such that they want to create something useful. They have to be mindful of the money involved and so forth. Designers and engineers are very similar. A perfect engineer can design a railway, and an outstanding engineer can create something good. But artists, the relationship between artists and engineer, and relationship between scientists and engineer is very important. As a definition of design, form follows function. That is an expression often used. If you have a function, then the form follows. Mary Ox often says that iPhone, if you look at the iPhone, if you work hard at designing a phone, this is not what you come up with. This is an art form. There's art. And then the design and engineer was combined after that to realize this. The real leap comes when there's science and art. If it's just design and engineers, they can do something which is a very democratic, where everyone wants to do, but something that changes the world is not generated as a result of this. What is important is that if you put four people in the same room of this category, they only fight and nothing happens because they're not aligned. You need all of these functions in one person. He can't do this simultaneously. Apple product development is such that business is not discussed at the initial meeting. They think about how people are thinking and how to create. And then afterwards, engineer and business people come in to discuss. So you need one person having all these functions. Moving back to education, you used to ask people to choose among these professions, but that's no good. One person has to be able to do all of this. Same with organizations. As a company, the company has to understand all of these And the companies should not be sectionalized with regard to these functions. And that's what's important going forward. And this is our laboratory. And one example from our laboratory, if you look at this, there's no one on the computer writing papers. They're all creating something. And when you're creating things, it's what is important is that you have the educator and designer and those who have a scientific background, robotic background. Here they're taking a robot, a prosthetic, and there is an expert on biology, neurology, or artificial intelligence, or dance. When we attach this prosthesis on a human being, we see it moving, and there's a rigorous process, and people learn a lot. When you create cities, it's the same. You try something, and you see when you try it, you know whether things are functioning or not. So you collect different people, and you create something, and then there's a learning process there. This is another example. This is Hugh Herr, one of our professors. He's lost two legs. He was mountain climbing and was in an accident, and he lost two legs. And he said he didn't want a walking stick, and he has prosthetics. In the case of legs, unlike arms, you need to be, if you know what angle and what you want to do, then the prosthetics move accordingly. Running and walking, we can manage with our prosthetics. Recently, at the Boston Marathon, there was a terrorism, and there was one lady that lost a leg, and she was a ballroom dancer. And dance is very difficult with prosthetics. The movement of the legs is very complex. And so at TED, he talked about this, so please have a look.
Breathes and lives dance. It's her expression. It is her art form. Naturally, when she lost her limb in the Boston terrorist attack, she wanted to return to the dance floor. We brought in dancers with biological limbs, and we studied how do they move, what forces do they apply on the dance floor. We took those data and we put forth fundamental principles of dance, reflexive dance capability, and we embedded that intelligence into the bionic limb. Her first performance since the attack, she's dancing with Christian Leitner.
This is a good example of the four Ps. They wanted to do a project and they collected students and everybody was willing to participate. And for her, they were all passionate and different people gathered to make this possible. One other important factor here is the following. Robotics researchers or people who write papers on robotics, and there are people who are working on robot legs. But when there's someone like her, it's not about robots anymore. You want to make her dance in a natural way. And what do you do to make that possible? That is the people's primary concern. And they're not concerned about the world's number one robotics technology. The only point is whether this has become possible or not. And the world is such that probably, whether it's companies or individuals, you tend to be confined in your own process and you only think about how to become number one in your small world. But when it comes to people, or when you think about natural development of the world, there are very few companies or people who are giving thought to this. There's a shortage of people who do that. So lastly, I'd like to talk about the cities once again. And there are lots of architects, so I should be very careful. But in the past, we have been thinking about cities centered around architects. And architects inevitably think about buildings and boxes, and that's their central concern. We have Kevin, professor, and I was talking to him in English and in Japanese. Among the words used by architects, they don't use the word user. They have a mass of people, but they don't look at cities from the standpoint of one individual. They focus on buildings. 1920s and 1930s, when Bauhaus was working with art and craft, and they collected all kinds of sectors to bring architecture to the next level, but there were lots of problems, and this didn't materialize. And in the 60s, Mr. Tange was central to the metabolism movement where he tried to introduce nature into architecture. That was very interesting. But inevitably, they tended to think in terms of objects, how to create buildings into the form of something which exists in nature. Nature-inspired architecture is what they were thinking about. And I showed different examples in the past. Technologically, genetic design was inconceivable in those days. In today's cities. In the cities, there's a certain atmosphere, and so that the natural design is possible. This is Mori Building's rooftop, and there are trees planted on the top of buildings. And inclusive of Mori Building, we've come to the point where very naturally we connect buildings, and that's a very important step. It's a flow of metabolism. The prosthetic you saw earlier on, normal prosthetics are such that you just connect. But when you connect, it has to be connected in a natural and beautiful way. And creatures and biology, we have to think in terms of complexity. And that should be the starting point of creating things and objects. And I think we can do that design in the future. Design up until now was such that, as mentioned before, before the internet, you imagined something and then you created something. That was design. But now things are so complex. You can do certain things. You don't know what will happen as a result of that. And what's easiest among creatures to understand is making children. You make children and you love the children and they are similar to you, but they don't do what you tell them to do. And if you change the environment, you want them to develop into the best human beings possible. That's what you do as a parent. You don't think that you should control your children and they have to be exactly what you tell them to do. That's a bad parent. And today's world is like this. So when people create something and design something, they take responsibility for that, and they create the best environment for what they've created, and they have to understand. But in the ultimate end, what happens as a part of the world, as to whether this something that you created serves the world or not, is something that you have to leave up to nature. And there's a humility required, a sense of humility required. In the future, when you design cities, it's very complex, whether it's a top-down approach is better or a bottom-up approach is better. A certain amount of top-down approach is necessary. You need designers. But within the design, how to think about the design and how to create a complex system design. In the science, there's a system biology, a complex system, trying to understand that and trying to design that, and know-how for that is being generated. But when it comes to cities and architecture, to incorporate this will becoming increasingly important going forward. Environmental issues are such that it's very complex, and you have to take this approach to these issues, inclusive of art. I think this will be a major theme and challenge. Thank you very much.
Ito-sama.
Thank you very much, Professor Ito.
それでは引き
Let us continue with the keynote address. Acting Minister and Permanent Secretary of Ministry of Culture of Thailand, Dr. Apinan Poshyanada, at Wilhood to be giving us the keynote speech. Creative Chaos, Art and Design for Chaotic Future. Please.
Good morning, Your Excellency, Mr. Minister Shimomura, Professor Haiso Takenaka, Mrs. Yoshikomori, Mr. Fumio Nanjo, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great, great pleasure and honor to be here at this seminal forum.I like to say that it's good news that Japan or Japanese have won Nobel Prizes, just been announced, but also to hear that there will be a typhoon coming soon. So please request the Nobel Prize winners to postpone the typhoon before I return to Bangkok, if possible.In exploring the future of our cities and the lifestyles of the people who live in them, we must find solutions, ways, and means in contributing to sustainable, and here I mean sustainable as long-lasting and non-destructive development. How cities become innovative. Cities.Are projected as innovative because creative people make them. However, creativity and imagination can be implemented and realized only when endorsed by cities' policy and people's willingness to change and accept transformation. My talk will attempt to sparkle your thoughts and provoke your views on how we interpret innovationin context of city development through art, design, and city planning. This is Bangkok in the 18th century. And this is the artist's vision of Bangkok in 2082. Chaos and creativity are keywords which I will beTalking in my lecture to reveal that Western perception and criteria of innovative city or creative city, especially by UNESCO standard, needs to be challenged as they tend to stress on urban regeneration, tourist destination, creative economy, and global consumption. In the age of chaos and disasters, innovative city and creative city needs to be defined and expanded.As we face with increasing frequency of natural and socio-political catastrophes that occur with sudden force and trauma. To be innovative, cities have to be adaptable to typhoons, earthquakes, tsunamis, simmering volcanoes, floods, landslides, plagues, viruses, and so on. Looking back in the past, we need to realize that our ancestors have been extremely creative and innovative. Sukhothai, Pagan, Borobudur, Prambanan, Varanasi, ancient sites are symbolic landmarks of faith that have survived time and environment to remind that creative innovation can be without high technology and advanced design. Varanasi in India,the ancient site of Hinduism and Buddhism, for centuries has been the holy city of Mother India. Varanasi is also the symbol of living chaos, innovation, prosperity, and hygiene are strange words, as citizens practice ritual where they throw corpses daily into the river Ganga and drink water. Ayutthaya, the ancient city of Siam, the highly celebrated through the eyes of European missionaries and travelers as Venice of the East. And look here at the structure of city planning of Ayutthaya, the ancient city of Siam. Today, websites display top cities selected and juried to announce their remarkable qualities and innovative ideas. Mostly, these cities are awarded and recognized due to creative ideas and urban cultural policy for new approach to synergy and the knock-on effect whereby regeneration and reinvention have transformed rundown areas into high-demand property. This is an example of modern Tate in London by the South Bank, or the Bilbao, Guggenheim, which transformed the sleepy Catalan town into a lively tourist spot, or Singapore, the Asian Renaissance city, with Marina Bay Sands and land reclaimed exotic artificial gardens. Cities around the world are transforming the way we live. A large number of architects, designers, social activists, and artists make up the creative class engaged with important social issues, including corruption, climate change, population growth, social injustice, and multiculturalism. Creative thinkers can act to inform public so that actions can be taken to shape our future. This is a work by Chinese artist Zhou Zhixi's Visions of Cities as Labyrinthine Maze, created as cartographic scribbles of endless creative journeys. Zhou's cities are real places such as Shanghai and Beijing, as well as utopian cities of never-ending layers of mess and conundrum. Sci-fi and drama filmmakers have projected their anxiety and predicament of our cities and future lifestyles. Prediction and premonition through scenes and incidents that foresee the rise and fall of megacities, contradictory to the eloquent architecture, happy living, and eco-friendly innovative cities promoted as ideal cities of the world. Instead, future cities constantly face threats, disasters, and detriment. On the other hand, producers of films such as Hangover 2, that you see here, Only God Forgives, or Lost in Thailand, use Bangkok as setting for their movies. In these cases, Bangkok is projected as innovative city, but is not created as innovative city, but one of complicated and uncontrollable mega city. I wish to draw attention to the notion of innovation and inventiveness in context of cities under chaos and trauma. Some cases of chaos from natural disasters and political movement in Thailand. For example, the tsunami in the south of Thailand in 2004, the Red Shirts and the Yellow Shirts schism, the Great Flood in 2010, and the demonstrations that led to military coup d'etat in 2014. And I give you some of these examples and share with you the context of how people have to adapt with such changes. 10 years ago, tsunami engulfed cities in the south, which you may know, Phuket, Krabi, and Phang Nga. On the Boxing Day, 26th of December 2004, killing more than 8,000 Thais and foreigners. The incident was one of the most shocking Thailand had faced in history, and I recall the trauma and the panic of the homeless victims. But I was assigned by the ministry, the government, to use art as a form of healing process to alleviate the feeling of traumatic experience by the victims. And this became a very, very memorable experience whereby artists, designers, creative thinkers volunteered to go down to these three provinces and create and design activities for the people over there. More than 30 public pieces were created exactly 1 year after the tsunami. You imagine how we had to clear the beaches, the detriment, the debris. But within 1 year, these artists managed to create new pieces for this occasion. The mission was to revive and rehabilitate the mental condition of those affected by tsunami. The healing process, as well as art activities, to draw visitors back to these tourist spots, wrenched and scarred by tsunami. The campaigns were considerable amount of effort taken by public and private sectors. Many victims became hydrophobic, whereby they were scared of water, and we had to find ways and means to let them be more focused, be more assured of what they are living and the ways they practice in life. So the process became one of that. I asked the artists to be involved. First of all, Thai artists, the ones who volunteered. But also we contacted international artists, because as you know, the news were internationally widespread. So some of the artists abroad also became very much involved. Yoshide Monara immediately answered that he would take part. But his view was that the trauma of people was realized, but the trauma of animals should not be forgotten. So he created this piece called Phuket Dog. And surprisingly, this Phuket Dog, after 10 years, is still standing at Pa Tong Beach. So Nara fans go there all the time, and when some of the people may climb on the dog or damage the dog, they will inform Nara. And we have to go and make the dog come back to life again. So small things like this, I think, became a catalyst, you know, where Japan and Thailand became very much linked through such incidents. I contacted this world-renowned performance artist, as you know, Marina Abramovich. I asked Marina, please come to do a performance. She came and stayed for 3 weeks. And she created this piece where she asked us to find 200 volunteers, and she and them started to whip the waves, slashing the waves as a symbolic gesture whereby her attempt to fight with nature, but at the end, accepting nature. And this became a very emotional piece by Marina Abramovich. I like to say that money was never involved. The artists and designers and the people just volunteered. You know, we may have to pay for their accommodation when they arrive, but they came with their heart. So this is, I think, innovation must talk about the heart also. Eh? Otherwise, you don't get things done. This is a work by a Thai artist called Udon Jitraksa. He was commissioned after 1 year of tsunami's event. Udon Jitraksa created this piece called Mind Universe, and now it's still placed as a permanent sculpture at the Muslim village called Kamala in Phuket. Udon created this piece just to talk about the universe, the survival, and the circles and ellipses that symbolize universe and people. The height of this piece is the height of the wave of tsunami that hit this village. So this piece becomes a reminder where when people return to Kamala or Phuket, they come and pay respect to this piece. This is the detail of Udon's work. So it became now a tourist attraction. This is one of the rare works by the world-renowned sculptress, Louise Bourgeois. You have the Louise Bourgeois at Mori Art Center, but when this event occurred, I went to New York and pleaded to Louise if it was possible for her to create a piece in memory of tsunami. Louise Bourgeois then was about 92 years old, about that. You know. So she took a while, but I did not know whether she knew of this event. But in her studio in New York, she said, oh, I saw it on TV, you know, and I would like to do something. So it became this piece. It took us about 6 months to create this piece. And that this work is called Hold Me Close. And it's a very emotional piece where Louise wanted to create this clasping hands in the symbol of praying. But she wanted to make a garden also. You know, so it became a garden of contemplation. And this work is placed at Gerbi province, where also the tsunami hit this beach. And the symbol of the child's hand, I think, is very poignant. Hold me close. So just to give you these examples whereby the way, you know, trauma and disaster could be evolved into something creative and innovative, but very much conscious to the artist's contribution to site specificity. During 2006 to 2014, until this year, there were many activities regarded turmoil, as you know, in Thailand. But don't forget that Bangkok became the most desired city to be visited 4 years in a row. So how do we manage this? How do we initiate ways of living and creating during such turmoil? And I'd like to give you some examples. At Mori Art Center, I came to see a show curated by Fumio Nanjo called Laughter. Yeah? And I was very much inspired to do a piece at the inaugural exhibition of the Bangkok Art and Cultural Center in Bangkok. Yeah? So I entitled the exhibition Traces of Siamese Smile. And this was during the turmoil, so like activities outside, but we had to open the art center. And this space is like 9 floors, and you might have been there, some of you, and the space is very, very spacious, very big. So we invited about 150 artists and designers to create their definition of traces of Siamese smile. Many Thai artists, of course, but also international artists. This work you see here is the work by the South Korean artist, Choi Chung-hwa, and also his inflatable flowers. And we also had a mini spider by Louise Bourgeois, because you have a giant one here in Tokyo, so we thought that we have a small one, and it was transported to Bangkok. But you know, when we showed it, the little spider, we could not send back to New York because the airport was closed. So our spider had to sit in the crate at Suvarnabhumi International Airport until the events of political skirmishes calmed down. Also works by Montin Bun Ma, the famous late Thai artist. works by David Mack, works by many, many artists, even two paintings here by a leading artist, Piriya, who painted portraits of our queen. Follow that, the events in Bangkok continue to be full of tensions. And there were activities whereby during the 14th ASEAN Summit held in Pattaya at the Royal Cliff Hotel, there were some events whereby the meeting had to be dispersed abruptly and sending Bangkok into a standstill where there were lots of demonstrations and riots. So what we did was created Bangkok Bananas. Bananas meaning that crazy. Yeah? And Bangkok Bananas meaning that Thailand can never make Bangkok Biennale. Because Biennale, yes, Richard, we cannot do it also. So we had to create an event whereby Bangkok Bananas became maybe annual activities. And here, the creative class, which I call them, really came out in force. And we did works inside and outside. Outside meaning during the curfew hours, where the military was still, you know, very much to be seen. So Bangkok Bananas became an invigorating event whereby a lot of people came out and enjoyed themselves. We showed films during the night, we showed performances at Siam Paragon or the central, you know, the main shopping areas, equivalent to maybe your Shibuya or Ginza. So we just wanted to send a message that despite everything, creativity survives and fun survives. I will talk about street art in a few minutes later, but just to show you that during those times, people had to adapt. And Bangkok became very innovative and creative because these people made them so. One of the projects we did was also a permanent sculpture. We wanted to make a permanent sculpture by international artists to be placed in this spot called the World Trade, right in the heart of Bangkok. So one of the artists we invited was this very famous Indian artist called Ravinder Reddy. Ravinder came and he looked at the space, but immediately we were sponsored by Indian Chambers of Commerce in Bangkok to help this sculpture to be made, because this sculpture, the head, was designed to celebrate our king's 80th birthday. It was made in Bangkok, the piece, and it was installed. Only a few weeks after that, there were some political gatherings by the political groups, and a lot of people, here you see them wearing red shirts, stayed at the World Trade Center. And eventually, there was this very unfortunate event where there was burning of this department store. And the sculpture became almost misinterpreted, that a lot of people thought that, you know, it was a symbol of bad omen or Kali, but it was not. You know, Reddy's intention was to make a beautiful piece in honor of Bangkok as a creative city. But anyway, we had to suffer this. And this image, I'm sure you saw, it was spread worldwide. This was 3 days after the event. But the whole of the area there, the center and the heart of Bangkok, became almost deserted, you know? And the mission again, how to bring back life and the sparkle to the city. This is Louis Vuitton deserted. Sad to say, but we will come back to this image, Louis Vuitton again. It took us 3 weeks, only 3 weeks, to gather 150 artists, designers, thinkers, to create this exhibition called Imagine Peace, whereby we invited both political groups and artists to contribute in the exhibition. It was a challenging project because the thinking of opposites were still quite prominent. I'd like now to give another example. We talked about cinema, we talked about the political turmoil. Now we talk about the Great Flood in 2010. You know, when floods came, you know, this time it did not come suddenly. It became a slow process where the deluge moved from north to south. They called it slow tsunami. And the psychological trauma was not fast. In reverse, it was slow, that this province is going to be hit, the next one, and Bangkok is going to get it sooner or later. And the precautions were that they tried very hard but could not stop such a great mass of water coming down, going out to Japaya River and into the sea. But when it hit so hard, you know? And some places and some people had to live with no electricity. You know, we went back to BI. We went back to the age where there's no, you know, internet because no electricity. And how to make use of, you know, the basic thinking and how to create low-tech to survive. When you cannot travel anywhere, when you're on the 50th floor of condominiums and you can't go up because the elevators don't work, how do you live? You know, how do you manage life? You know, yesterday, Gitadat also talked about this matter, how to design in order to survive. So it was almost like going back to the basics, whereby the essentials were necessary, and design and creativity had to be thought very fast. Like this. You know, there used to be bridges and streets, but when it's like covered with water, how do people manage? You know, so the bridges, the tollways became parking lots, because people could not travel anywhere. Here is the factory site by Japanese company in the Yutaya, totally submerged, and all these automobiles were ruined. Also, Thai International could not fly because full of water, and the airport, one of the airports, had to be closed, Don Mueang International Airport. But people, after a while, their sense of humor came back. And the way people managed to survive was quite incredible. Live as you like, inspired by AP. AP is company, it's not Apinan Poshananda, it's AP, yeah? And to see this image, I go back to the image of Yoshitomo Nara, you know. How do people manage, you know? But the pets have to live also, you know, how to feed them. You know, they have to find water, they have to find food. But colliding ideas became quite productive. And people who are not artists, you know, Ito-san said, you know, designers, you know, urbanists, engineer, these people had to be, you know, make do instant creative thinkers. Like this, how to help your friend. Or like this, how to help your friend swim across the river. Or like this. But this is totally useless, you know, because
Psychologically, you wrap it so that I think it's Honda. Honda or Hyundai, I'm not sure. But you wrap it because you think that it will be okay. But it's not okay because when you unwrap it, it gets totally moldy. You know, you cannot drive it. So, but it's like the idea of it, the idea of trying to save your property. But after a while, you cannot fight with nature. Nature always wins, always. This is going to work. Car become boat. Or this famous tuk-tuk. Because if the tuk-tuk comes touching the water, it will stop because the water will get into the engine. So they have to find ways and means to... It became a lot of fun because when people drive, you know, you get the different level of elevation. Again, going to work. How people get ideas to design what they have to cope with such a situation. And the whole country almost became paralyzed. You know, certain areas, no electricity, nothing, abandoned. You know, we have to go out and give people survival kits, survival bags. I love this photo because this husband is taking his wife for a morning float. You know, I think this is very touching. So just to stress that when you find yourself in certain corners, situations, you have to become low-tech designers. But this transvestite became very famous because she or he, I call he or she, I'm not sure, but he she was stranded in his house and didn't know what to do, so he put it on the Facebook, you know, Facebook, and people became interested. And he began to make his own mermaid kit. And people loved him. His or her name is Bo, now very famous person. So you get the sense of humor, and design can be anywhere. Another artist I want to mention, because he showed at the Mori Art Center, is called Pontavisak Rimsakun. Pontavisak also designed this, you know, how to make art functional, using tires and pedals and part of the automobile. This design was in the exhibition called Let's Panic. Let's Panic. And this became his work. And he actually used it to go around and became very, very attractive, and people loved it. Obviously, sometimes it broke down, like now, because artists sometimes don't design well. They only think. And yesterday, I think Marco, I'm not sure, talked about the cleaners. You know, I'm not sure. Did you? Another. Jason. I'm not sure, one of the speakers. I was very touched because the process of cleaning can also be creative and meditative, you know. So this was like everyone came out after the flood. It was like communal work, doing it together and clean. You know, you need to clean the city also. Sometimes people think that other people clean your city, other people clean your home. But this is a process whereby everybody came out and work together and create it together. So just the process of sweeping and cleaning can be very, very creative. After the flood came another event whereby Bangkok again stopped and got jolted. Lots of, again, demonstrations. These are all people, huh? And they all come out. This is the very symbolic monument. democracy monument. But after a while, demonstrations became fashionable and creative. And I just like to look at this point of view, whereby demonstrations became a lot of fun. Again, Louis Vuitton, huh? Very symbolic spot where, you know, this also became the mass of people. But the way they dressed up, they knew that almost every day, daily and nightly, they would come out. And it became the chance, because all the streets were closed, it became the chance to dress up, to meet new boyfriends and girlfriends, to socialize, make friends, make activities. And the costumes and the dress became quite sophisticated. Designers became involved, you know, how to design very chic t-shirt, headbands, armbands, and it sold like hotcakes, you know. So it became an industry whereby some tourist companies say that, let's bring the tourists here because they can come and watch the demonstrations. Because these demonstrations, you get free food, free wine, free beer, and it's like a carnival, and you have a party. Like she, you know, this is like in the middle of the street. She would have a big party with her friends, sorry. Also, catwalks, catwalks on the street, plays, stand-up comedies, all these events became like a biennale, like an art festival. So accidentally, we could not make Bangkok Biennale, but this became an event whereby more people enjoyed, they didn't call it art, they call it event. Even on the streets, you know, artists painted the streets, painted the city. The city of Bangkok became the canvas for the artists. And they came out of the galleries. They moved out of the galleries and they created works for the masses, for the people. So I like to end by showing this photo, picture, of when the event of 22nd of May this year occurred, where there was a coup d'etat. The coup d'etat was bloodless, like most coup d'etats in Thailand, anyway. But the coup d'etat was seen as inevitable and necessary. But the mood of the people, like here, you know, the soldiers and the army became quite creative and contributed much to bringing back happiness to the people. This is, I end with this slide. This is the exhibition created by some very young Thai artists. And they wanted to look into the future of Bangkok. And it translates, or it writes here, what is your Bangkok in 2082? You know, their visions and their views, whether it be optimistic or pessimistic, is the view of the artists and the designers' prediction of the future. But as Tetsuya Mizuguchi yesterday poignantly observed in his talk, whose city is it? Designed for whom? Want and desire for what purpose? Having achieved want, then move on for new desire? These are the questions I think that we need to ask ourselves. So in summary, cities are fragile and ephemeral.
some more than others, our tasks are to keep their uniqueness and attraction. But above all, we must keep them from being distracted from what we might term as something we called development or innovation. Because sometimes the best way of being innovative is simply to do nothing, hence achieving the void. Thank you.
Apinan-sama, domo arigato.
Thank you very much, Dr. Apinan.